Okay, so shall we make a start then? Welcome to Network Simulation and Traffic Management. Yes, I need to eventually replace the title on that slide because it's just the old title of the module, but it's fine. You know what you're doing anyway. So we'll be meeting here every Friday morning. Okay, you don't need to sit on the specific computer that you're working on because you are logging in with your user accounts. So you can sit on whichever computer is free at any given time. And of course, as I mentioned last week, you can always remote in if you're not feeling well. So I have two of these today, as you can probably see. All right. So we'll be working with OpenNet. Hello, have a seat. Not in the last two rows anywhere, please. So we'll be working with OpenNet. It's a program that's used for network simulation. It's one of the most fancy ones out there, if you will. It is also one of the most ridiculously priced ones. So I actually had to do the quote for 110 licenses for this year yesterday, and it worked up to 27,000. Ridiculous for a year. Anyway, it's pretty good. Yes. So what we'll learn to do is we'll learn how to simulate networks on it, and we'll learn how to implement protocols and network optimization techniques. All right. We'll start with the very basic concepts of everything, you know, what networks are, how you simulate a network and why you simulate the network. And then we'll move on to things like QoS and so on. Okay. So today's lecture is lecture one, and it's devices in an internet connection. So the first thing that we need to do when we want to create a network is we need to identify its attributes. So when, let's say, you are a company that needs to build a network for a customer, one of the first things that you need to identify is you need to identify the attributes of the network. So why is the network, what is the network being used for? What do they need it for? What special considerations are there for this network? Does it do anything specific? Does it specialize in anything? Or do you just want to provide internet access for people to browse the web on it? So what is the network's purpose in life? All right. Once you do that, you then need to go one step further down and define the attributes of the devices that you will use themselves. So you need to choose the hardware. So you need to choose how everything will be connected, what sort of links you will have between all of the computers in the network, how that network will connect to the outside world. So what links to the outside world you will have, and so on. And then once you do that, of course, you need to decide on the software that will be used as well in the network. So what will all of the nodes actually run on? And then furthermore, and more to our interest, is what sort of routing protocols you will use, what sort of network optimization techniques you will use, and so on. So this abstraction is dependent on the context of the object. So whether the network itself or the specific device in the network, what is it actually used for? What do you actually do with it? And another important factor as well is cost. Okay, so if you have all the money in the world to build a network for the military or the government or something, then you know, you're golden. But most scenarios in normal private companies are not like that. And cost is one of the biggest issues when building a network. All right. So a simulation will basically help you identify what is really important. So you would have, for example, the situation where you need to build a network. You kind of have an idea of what devices you want to use on it. You think you know how you want to connect everything, but you would like to try it out. All right. So the best way to do that would be to actually run a simulation, because if you go out, buy the equipment, install it, configure it, and then run it, and it's not running as it should, then you've done something wrong during the design stage. And now this is usually something ridiculously expensive. Okay, so depending on the scale of the network and the purpose of the network, you can't really afford to do that. All right. You might also have the situation where you have an existing network and you need to upgrade it. So you've been asked to optimize the network of a particular company. And there are various ways to do that. You can upgrade the hardware, or you can change the software, or you can implement something like QoS, for example, and so on. So there are lots of different ways to go about it. So running simulations with different scenarios of different possible solutions would be the most efficient way for you to actually do this. So networks have their attributes and have their variants and invariants. So you will have the end nodes in a network that will be your users. So everybody that's actually the human element of the network. You will have all of your routers and nodes in between. So everything that takes part in the routing of information in a network. Okay, and everything that has to do with that. And then of course you will have the links, which is everything that actually connects everything together. And you need to figure out what the best way to connect everything is and what the best links to use actually are for this. Now, you need to simulate a network. What do you actually do and why do you do it? So experimental design. You form a hypothesis, you create a methodology, and then you make an analysis of that. So let's say, for example, if I give you a coursework, you don't just do the coursework because I gave it to you. Okay, I will tell you, I need you to build a network that does this and this and that, and it has this specification and it's supposed to use these services. Okay, so what you need to do is you need to create a hypothesis. So I will build a network that contains these sort of routers, these sort of workstations, these sort of links between it, these routing protocols. It will run these applications inside it. The applications that it will run, the traffic that it will create will be that specific amount of traffic. So I want to see if that thing actually works. Okay, so then you form a methodology for it and you say, okay, so I will start with all the routers of the network to create the backbone. Then I will include all of the nodes and all of the subnets that I need in every location. Then I will connect everything up. Then I will configure the traffic and then I will configure the simulation and run it. And then the analysis of this is I will run the simulation, get the results and see if the thing works correctly. So for example, one of the things that you can test for is see if your network is fast enough or if it's underloaded or overloaded. Okay, so the hypothesis would be that you need to check the performance of a network. So to check the performance of the network, the best way to do it is to run simulation with the traffic that you have, and the methodology part of it will be to actually choose to get the results back for, let's say, link capacity. All right, you run the simulation, and then you look at your results, you look at the link capacity there, and you see whether a link is 20% utilized, 40% utilized, 100% utilized. If it's 100% utilized or close, it means that your network is working at its limits, okay? And you will have bottlenecks in your network somewhere. All right, the same goes with application performance even more. So you can get the end-to-end delay of an application on a network. You know from theory what that should be for an application to work. So let's say, for example, for video streaming, you need to have a maximum of 150 milliseconds delay, end-to-end delay between sender and transmitter. Okay, so you run it, and then you look at the results of the application, and you see how much the end-to-end delay actually is. If it's less than 150, you're okay. If it's more, then you will have a problem with your network. Okay, so you create a simulation, you configure it in a specific way, and then you look at the results of it and make some conclusions from it. Reasons to simulate. So we need to analyze the impacts of different network designs, so different topologies or technologies used or routing algorithms or different network configurations that you might have. You can run technology benchmark for comparison. So we say, okay, so I want to implement SNMP. So I want to see how the network performed before SNMP and after. So you make two scenarios, you compare exactly the same results and you see if a specific application, for example, performs better or not. And of course, this will help you gain a deeper understanding of how your network actually works and what it does. Yes, you could do this physically if you have network analyzers in a physical network, okay? But that may not always be the case. So you might not actually have physical access to the network itself, or of course, it might be a lot more laborious to actually go around with a network analyzer and run everything. Whereas with a simulation, you can actually set the traffic that runs in the network to whatever you want it to be. So for example, if you're testing a network live at any given point during the day, you might be unlucky and not get the network at its worst. You might not get the network at a time when it's utilized to its full potential. Whereas you in a simulation, you can put the maximum traffic that you know the network will ever have and see if the network can actually take that traffic load or not. And much of the current protocols and devices were developed through simulation. So another thing that you can do is you can actually, and I will show you this in OpNet, you can actually implement or create your own different protocol. Okay, so it goes down to a programming, C programming level. So you can create your own nodes, you can create your own protocols to run in there, so you can make the simulation do whatever you want it to do. Okay, it does provide lots of flexibility. Of course, this is beyond the scope of what we want to be doing here. Okay, but we have PhD students, and we've had in the past, that have implemented, for example, rain mitigation fading techniques. Okay, so you can do these sort of cool things with this as well. Simulation outcomes. So you get insights to design, so you understand the traffic and the technologies that are being used. So if you run the simulation and you see how the traffic behaves, then you can get a better understanding overall of the network performance and how the application actually works in the network. So is it spiky HTTP traffic? Is it constant video or voice traffic and whatnot? You get confidence in evaluation. So does the topology fit with the characteristics of the network? So, you know, have you connected everything in the best possible way or not? Is the technology used appropriately? You might implement something, but that is not needed in the end. So it's unnecessary. So just add the network complexity for no reason. So why would you do it? You know, you don't need to. Are your algorithms effective and efficient? So is it, you know, is BGP or is IGRP the best algorithm to use for routing on the external side of things? So you decide to do that. Can we predict future events, and will the current design scale? So basically, yes, they've asked you to build a network for them or to optimize a network. It works fine now, but will it work better in the future? So let's say that you have a company and they have 1,000 employees. What would happen if the company expanded and it went up to 1,500 employees? Would the network still be able to cope with the traffic? So you have certain advantages of running simulations. So you have flexibility to choose the desired time and time accuracy. So you can run a simulation for as long as you like, or rather, that's a bit of a lie. You can run a simulation for as long as your CPU power can take. Okay. All simulations, everything that's CAD related is very CPU hungry. Okay. That's why all of the computers on this floor are Xeon CPUs. Okay. We don't just like to buy the most expensive stuff. So it depends on, so you can adjust how much time of it, of a network you want to simulate, right? It's not limited to analytical or tractable mathematical models. So you throw in the traffic in the network and you see what it actually does. So you don't have, for example, if you were using MATLAB, you would be limited as to what MATLAB can actually do or what you can program in MATLAB. It is a little bit true in the sense of what you can actually program in OpNet and what you can do in OpNet as well. But the way that it runs the simulation is not so dependent on you programming every little detail of the simulation process itself. Okay, so it has its own nodes, it has its own links and everything else. It has its routing protocols that have been designed already. So you just throw all of this into the mix and see what actually happens with the traffic. And you don't, you're working on a bit of a higher level. You don't need to program all of the components themselves. So it's a bit more flexible and easy to use. It gives you an alternative system design with ease to evaluate. So you can have a simulation that has multiple different scenarios. And you can have each of the scenarios with a different technology or a different topology or different amount of traffic or different type of traffic running it. And then you can compare all of them in one go in the end, because you can simply compare all of the results. It gives you alternative operating conditions and policies for existing systems. So you can build a simulation of the network as it exists out in the real world, and then you can make changes to it and say, okay, so what if we changed a specific firewall policy on one of the main firewalls of the company, what would happen? So you can simulate it without actually doing the change in the company's firewall and risking the security of the network itself. And finally, lets you keep control over experimental conditions. So you can see exactly what's happening when you want it to happen. So you, if you want, for example, a link to be randomly disconnected at some time, you can set the link to be disconnected at the time so that you see what bad that does, what effect that has on the network itself. Disadvantages, of course, it's only an estimation of model's true characteristics. So it might not be 100% accurate. It might be 95% accurate. Okay. Development can be expensive and time consuming. So if it's not something that the software already includes, so if you might need to simulate a device that's not actually there, or a protocol that hasn't been implemented in .NET yet, then you would have to make it. So that means programming, that means a lot of time. Also, as I mentioned, simulation software can be expensive as well. So it's a trade-off analysis of whether you actually do need to buy this and use it, or use one of, another network designer that is free, is less capable, but doesn't really cost you anything, right? It's time consuming to run simulations, and it's dependent on the statistics you choose to view, the amount of data, and the length of time you simulate for. So if you have a big network that has lots of traffic and you choose lots of results from it, then it will run much slower than a network that you haven't chosen so many results from it, because you can choose exactly what results you want to get out of the simulation. Yes. So if you want to get link utilization and application performance, and then you run another simulation that only requires application performance, then that second simulation will run faster simply because the results for that second attribute are not being recorded anywhere. Okay, so that matters as well. It has persuasive impact of large volume data, so you need to use statistical inference, so you will get lots of data out of simulation. Yes, the program will show you nice graphs and everything, but you might need to convert them. Okay, so you will have that problem as well. And then it gives you a lack of insight into underlying laws, for example. So it doesn't take into consideration other elements of a network, like the human factor. So you say, yes, okay, the policy of the network is that, all users must have their computers and must lock them at all times and blah, blah, blah. And that's how you set up your security policy, and you set up your firewalls and your DMZ zones and everything. But then someone just, decides that they don't want to have a password on their computer and just leave it blank. And that's it. Okay, so it's game over for your network, because your network cannot compensate for that. So there are different things like that. And of course, underlying laws. So for example, yes, you are choosing to create links that connect London to Portsmouth or whatever, but would you actually physically be able to dig up and create these links? Or would you have to lease these links from somewhere else, from another, from a tier one ISP, for example? And how much capacity would they give you? How much would that cost, and so on? So there are other considerations to be made, okay, that cannot be included in the simulation itself. Okay, so that's that for this one. All right, so what I will do now is I'll go through the first lab sheet that I have. I need to do a few things. So I need to change this to the PC. And I need to change, stop sharing, and do this wonderful thing. So yes, I have my lovely webcam with me, because I can't have Zoom on the Linux box here and be logged in simultaneously. So that's a bit of an acrobatic to do. All right. So let me sort this out a bit. Okay. So you will have lab sheets. They will tell you what to do. In the beginning, they will be step by step. All right. But later on, it will be go on and do this. All right, so it starts slow with building a network and everything else and teaching you how to actually use OpenNet itself. And then we'll go on to actually creating complicated networks and implementing technologies on them that we need to implement and use. So the first lab sheet is about generating traffic. So this is the simplest way that you can do it. Okay, it has some introductory stuff here. So you start OpenNet, you create a network and so on. And in fact, I think it should be better if I just do it and show you. So let me check. Okay. All right, so good. you can do everything as I do everything as well. Okay, so if you want, you can start OpNet. It's in applications. I'm gonna say apps menu and then local OpNet modeler. Okay, so it's here. Okay, for the two people that are on Zoom, you can't do this yet because you haven't connected, but this is all being recorded, so you should be able to see it later. Okay, so what does the LabSit say? OpNet is a network, blah, 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 introduction stuff. Good. Once you start OpNet, click on File, New. You will be presented with a screen below. So, File, New. So it's a new project. Okay, we'll always develop projects, so you should click OK and then give the project an appropriate name. So I'm going to name this lab_1 and I'm going to put a 2021 next to it because I also have 2020, 2019, 18, and so on. All right, don't press enter yet. And also call the scenario something appropriate. For example, if you're doing an experiment with MPLS, it should be called with MPLS. Okay. Don't move further from this on because this is a little bit, in the next few pages, a little bit of explanatory stuff of how everything works. Okay. So you have components that you will typically use. So you have subnets. These are logical subnets. So if you're building a big network that spans across multiple cities, then it's best to actually have one subnet per city and then go inside each of these subnets and connect it. And if you have any routers and everything else on the outside, you can place them on the outside and it's fine. You have a box that's called Application Configuration Utility Block. So this is what defines the applications that will be available for you to use during the simulation. Okay, so in the simulation, you will have email, HTTP, and video traffic. All right, then you have the profile configuration. So after you have the application configuration box set up with the applications that will be available in the network in general, you will need to tell the specific users of the simulation how to actually use and how much of to actually use those applications. So you might create a profile that's called video. Okay, so you might have some users that are only video conferencing, and you might have some other users that are sending email and web traffic through the network. So you create a profile that's called user two or normal users, and they only use email and HTTP traffic. So with those two blocks are the building blocks of the application that you will use in your network. You then have, let's say for example, an Ethernet 32 hub. So that simulates an Ethernet hub with 32 connections on it. So you can connect up to 32 devices on it. You have an Ethernet 16 switch. So that's a switch and not a hub. And it has only 16 connections available for you to use. You can have an Ethernet 4 Sleep 8 gateway. So this will be a big router that has 4 Ethernet ports and 8 sleep or point-to-point serial connections on it. And they are available for longer distances than Ethernet. You have an Ethernet workstation. So this simulates a computer, essentially. You can have a LAN, which simulates a lot of computers connected at the same time through a switch. So I think this defaults to 10. So one of these is 10 workstations on the network. Okay, but you can change the number as well if you need to. And you can have an Ethernet station, which is something more basic. It just simulates an end-to-end sender or receiver of data. So you can configure traffic data to be protocol independent. So this is a more base model and send it across the network. And then you can have the links. So you can have a 100 BAST or you can have PPP links and so on. And then you have the traffic flows, which is something that we'll see later on. So there are traffic flows will basically stipulate a specific amount of traffic that goes from a specific sender to a specific receiver. All right. So let's start with building a simple network. So OpenNet, file new, create new project. Let's call it lab one. And let's name the scenario hub problems. Parenthesis. No one anymore ever uses hubs. If you see a hub somewhere, burn it. Yes? We're only using it here so that I show you what sort of things in the most basic level you can do with OpenNet as a simulation software. So we will compare a hub to a switch. All right, so this is as simple as it can go without it being completely silly. All right, so scenario, let's name it hub problems. Problems. I always use underscores between them because this is Linux that we're working on and doesn't really like spaces too much sometimes. So I'm just being very careful, okay? Click OK. Perfect. What's wrong? Do I already have this? Of course I do. My God, it's going to be 2022 next year. Okay, so you must now create an empty scenario, okay? Because you can create other scenarios as well. So we create an empty scenario, leave it as this and click next. And we need to click on office size. So there's world, enterprise, campus, we click on office. Click next. Set the dimension to something you feel is relevant. So let's say an office of, I don't know, 20 by 20 meters. Click next. And then click finish. So this last bit is asking you to choose which technologies you want to be involved. So you don't need to choose any of them, because I think by default, it opens up the internet toolbox. So I'll show you. Finish, there's a review of everything. Yes. Okay. So it opens the object palette, and there is a specific section of the object palette that's called internet toolbox. You can have sections by devices, sections by technology, sections by connection, and so on. So the internet toolbox contains most of the most important aspects that we will need on a network, most of the most important components that we'll need in a network. All right, so I'll move this to the side a bit. So we have LANs, we have workstations, we have Ethernet, we have the application configuration box and everything else. So you should now be presented with an empty network domain, which is all of this space, all right, and an object palette that gives you the selection of objects for you that you can put into your workspace. You can left click to select an object, let's say the Ethernet workstation, and drag that object onto the network domain. So we're going to E and we're looking for Ethernet workstation. Left click, drag and drop, and that's it. It still remains selected. So if I want to drop more down, I can. Okay, so if I right click, it disengages. If something is selected like this, they have this circle around them, it means that you can do stuff to it. So I can delete, for example. All right. So I'm going to get one Ethernet workstation in place, and then I'm going to left click to release. And if I right click again, it just puts it into its place. All right. Remember that the network domain is distance dependent, so it does matter where you put it. So you see on the top, there's 0, 5, 10, 20 meters, and so on. Okay. Right click will deselect that component. And if you right click on the object, you have to put in the network domain and click on edit mode, edit node model for that object. So if I right click and choose edit node model, then I get this. I'll wait until you all catch up. I think some of you are stuck. So when I right click to have a menu, it doesn't appear straight away. Yeah. I need to keep my mouse pressed with the left button and just scroll over it. I think it's a feature of Cedric's installation, to be honest. So yeah, so if I right click, nothing happens. And then if I click and keep the button pressed, it can reveal all of them. And then I release the button wherever I want it to go. And that was, you know. I don't know why. And I'm sure the guys haven't figured it out yet either. Okay, so there's a task, list what components make up that object and identify what they do. Okay, so you have a CPU, you have the application stack, you have the Mac, and so on. So you can actually click on this as well. So if you just double click, it will give you the process model. So now we're going deep into the level of what actually everything consists of. So a workstation consists of all of the components that make it work. It has a DHCP protocol support. It has a RIP routing protocol support. It has UDP. It has TCP connection stack. It has the IP encapsulation. It has the hubs. It has the CPU and everything else. So if you click on the Mac, then you can see all of the logical diagram, this logical state diagram that makes it think, makes it work. If you click on one of them, you can see actually the code that makes up each of the steps of this. Okay, so this is just to scare you and intimidate you. You're never going to use this. No, I just want you to know what's in there. Okay, and just to know that, you know, you can explore, you can just go in and click on stuff and see what they do and how they actually work. Okay. So double click on a component, for example, Mac, and look at the state transition diagram. This shows you the logical function of that component, and then its state has entry code and exit code, and this code can be seen by double clicking on the top or the bottom of its state. The code protocol is Proto-C, which is a variant of C, specially designed for operant. And you can close the model and close the node and the model windows, and you can delete the object that you put in the network domain because you don't need it anymore. The whole purpose of its existence was just so that you can click inside it and be scared. All right. So now you have looked at the functional makeup of operant. You can put together nodes onto the workspace and see what components they are made up and change which palette you're using to have a selection of other objects. For example, you can look at the difference between a workstation and the router. So in your own free time, you can just play around with the components and see what differences they have. So for this example, we're going to create a network using the topology creator. Select topology, rapid configuration from the main menu, and choose a start configuration. So topology, again, keep pressing on it. This is really annoying. Right, so we have topology. Where is it? Rapid configuration. Okay, so topology, rapid configuration. Instead of a bus, you're going to change this to a star. Click next. So now it will ask you what that needs to consist of. All right. So let's see. From select models, choose the Ethernet model. So select models. Okay, we go for Ethernet. Click on it again. And if you keep it up here, it will scroll up. All right. So looking for E. Ethernet. Keep the button pressed, keep the left button pressed at all time while you're doing this. Okay, so model list is Ethernet. And click OK. I'm gonna go slow so that I wait for all of you to sort this out, yeah? Now, the center node for this experiment is going to be an Ethernet 16 hub. So center node model is Ethernet 16 hub, which is this one. And the periphery nodes, of which we'll need 16, is the Ethernet station. So we have Ethernet station. Be careful not to choose workstation here because the simulation will not work. It's a different thing. Okay, so Ethernet station, and we want 16 of these nodes. Okay, so the Ethernet station doesn't actually do anything else. So it just sends and receives traffic. It doesn't actually, you cannot configure applications on it. Okay, it's a more low level sort of entity. The connections will be 10 base T. Ha, they removed it, 100 base T, doesn't matter. You do?
Yeah.
Why? Ah, there it goes. It's blind. It's fine.
It wasn't visible.
Okay. So we have the center node, the periphery node, and the link model. We click OK. Ta-da! All right. So this is a network creation for lazy people. Sorry, I mean efficient. Yeah? So now you have your network topology. You have everything connected. It all looks very pretty, and it's all named correctly, node 0 to node 15 and so on. All right. So you will configure all of the nodes in your network to have the same properties. Rather than setting the properties for each individual node, you can do this automatically. Right-click on any workstation and click Select Similar Nodes. Right-click. Got it. Okay. It's a bit tricky, so I'll just click, right-click, move your mouse a bit further to the menu, keep pressing the left button, and you have select similar nodes. So this will only select the 16 workstations without selecting the links or the hub in the middle. All right. All nodes should now be selected. And on the bottom left, it actually says 16 nodes selected. So this is verification so that you know what happened. Because you might have a big network that has lots of different subnets and you want to configure all the workstations in there. You click and do select all, but you can only see like 5 out of 100, but that will tell you 100 nodes selected. All right. Right, so right click on any of the nodes and then select and choose edit attributes. So right click, move the mouse, select attributes is the first option. So click on it. You will be shown the node attributes box. Right. It's from here that you can configure any node attributes. So traffic generating attributes, router configuration, etc. In order for the changes you make to this node to be applied to all other nodes, you must check the apply changes to selected objects box. It's down here on top of OK. So apply to selected objects. You now need to expand the traffic generation parameters by clicking on the little cross next to it. All right. And the packet generation arguments, which is under it. Okay, so we're at packet generation arguments. Set the on state time to an exponential distribution with a mean of 100. So, packet size. Another magical thing it does, it opens new boxes behind the existing box. So, ta-da! I know, right? It would be too easy otherwise, you know? So what's on with exponential mean of 100? So wait, this is the wrong thing. Ooh, I've lost it. Isn't that great? On state, off state. Okay, great. Okay, fine. So traffic generation parameters, on state time, off state time. The on state time is exponential with a mean of 100. And the off state time to a constant of 0. It's going to be interesting. So what does this mean? It means that the traffic is always on. All right. So constant exponential increase of 100 seconds. Then we go into the packet generation arguments and set the inter-arrival time to a constant of 0.02. So packet generation arguments, arrival time constant 0.02, and the packet size to constant 1500 bytes. Okay, so four details that we changed in here. The first one is the on state, we set it to exponential 100. The second is the off state time, we set it to constant 0. The third is the inter-arrival time, constant 0.02. So each of the packets arrives every 0.02 seconds. All right. And the packet size is 1,500 bytes every 0.02 seconds. All right. So if we click OK, on the bottom left, we'll get 16 objects changed. So this is verification that the changes that we made actually took place in all of the nodes in the network that we selected. Okay, so now we've set up our traffic generation parameters in the simplest way possible on the workstation itself. So now we can choose what statistics we want to get out of this. All right, before you simulate the network, you must choose which statistics you want to record while the simulation is in progress. If you right click anywhere in the workspace, though not on the objects, and select choose individual DS statistics, you can select statistics that you want to obtain for all the nodes in your workspace. So right click, reveal the menu, choose individual DS statistics. You can also do this if you go to the DS menu up here and choose statistics. All right. So, of course, if you right click on a particular node or connection, you can select the statistics for that particular object only. Okay, so just keep that in mind for the future. Expand the global statistics box and select Ethernet delay from Ethernet, traffic received in bits, and traffic sync. And traffic from traffic sync and traffic sent from traffic source. Okay, so global, let's find this. And we want Ethernet, we want delay, and from the traffic source, we want traffic sent in bits per second. So that's the second one. And from the traffic sync, we want traffic received in bits per second. Okay. So nodes will be sending information and nodes will be receiving information. Okay, so we have Ethernet delay, we have traffic received on the sync, and we have traffic sent on the source. Both of them in bits per second. Click OK. Oh, and also you can expand the node statistics and Ethernet and select collision count. So node statistics, Ethernet, and collision count. Sorry, I was too fast to move there. So this is everything that needs to be selected for your results. All right, we click OK, click on configure run simulation. Ironically, it's a running guy. They thought it was funny probably. And we want to set the duration for 3 minutes. Okay, and we run it. Okay, so on here you can click on the results browser once the simulation is finished. And you can look at your results. So global statistics, Ethernet delay. A lovely squiggly line. Now when you're looking at results, you can look at them in different ways. I prefer to look at them as time average. Okay, because this makes more sense for especially spiky traffic. So this is the delay. Another thing that we can do is we can manipulate the view between two. So let's say that we have the traffic received and we have the traffic sent. All right. If I click where it says stacked statistics, I can change it to overlaid statistics. And this is the most useful view so that you can compare different scenarios or different behaviors of nodes. So in this graph, we have in blue, traffic sync, traffic received, and then we have in red, traffic sent. So in red, we can see that we've sent out this many bits per second, and we have received these many bits per second. Some of them seem to have gotten lost along the way. Yes, because we should be receiving what we're sending, no? How much traffic does its node generate? How much traffic is transmitted in the network? And what is unexpected in your results and why is this happening? So I will let you think about this. Okay. And the fourth one is, what effect does changing the on and off state times, interval time, and packet size have on the system? So I will let you the rest of the time to play around with these changes and see exactly what actually happens. Okay.
Vas.